Now, obviously, the biggest talking point this week was about the princes and the press, a BBC documentary tracking the media's role in the fallout between the Duke and Duchess of Sussex and the rest of the royal family. For the latest, we're going to turn to the Mail's royal editor, Rebecca English, right now, who joins us via Skype. Hi, Rebecca.
Hello, Jo.
And now, Rebecca, the trouble started for this documentary before it was even on air, didn't it, with the royal households rather miffed that they didn't get early access to it.
Absolutely, and it may be worth just going back even one step before that and pointing out that a lot of the people I know that were interviewed for the programme did those interviews more than a year ago. So it's been a long time in the making, and actually a lot has happened in the royal world, as anyone who watches this programme regularly will know between now and then. But yes, they were very, very unhappy, and it's really kind of two reasons for this. Is firstly, they were only asked very recently if they wanted right to reply. And of course the question was, what do we need right to reply for? And there are various things that come up in this documentary, most notably the suggestion by some people who've been interviewed that royal aides were leaking information left, right and centre about Harry and Meghan, possibly with the blessing of the people that they work for, which is obviously a very, very serious allegation. And the palace did ask to see the documentary in full. I have some sympathy with BBC there. You know, why should they have to show it in full? But what really annoyed them was that in order to react to those very serious allegations, they were only given very broad brushstrokes of what was in it, not even told who was appearing or what claims they were making. So they feel very, very aggrieved by this.
Do the royal family normally have an expectation that they would see such documentaries beforehand from the BBC?
I think if it was something that they were working with them on, like something regarding a Queen's Jubilee or a big kind of birthday celebration, then yes. But obviously, this is a work of journalism, and journalists shouldn't be expected to have to kind of hand over everything they've got. But you are expected to have good journalistic practice and talk those you're writing with, or, you know, in this case, broadcasting about, through in detail anything that might affect them. And, you know, the palace's fear, and I use the word palace's advisedly, because although this is being driven by Kensington Palace by Prince William and his team, they are absolutely in lockstep with Buckingham Palace and Clarence House in how annoyed they are. They just feel that proper journalistic practice wasn't followed in this case.
You used the word annoyed there. What is the mood that you know of in the family now that the first part of the documentary has been out?
As I said, it's not so much what's contained in it. It's the practice that went into it. It's the way the BBC went about this. And I think this will, obviously, on the back of everything that happened over Martin Bashir, have serious ramifications for the BBC's relationship with the royal family for some time to come.
Early ramification, apparently, is there's a Christmas Carol concert that's been a bit of a casualty of the fallout. What can you tell us about that?
Yeah, it has, and this is quite a big move by the royal households. William and Kate were due to collaborate with the BBC on a charity carol concert at Westminster Abbey next month, and they've basically pulled it, and they've handed the opportunity to broadcast it over to ITV. It happened very suddenly at the end of last week, and I don't believe the ITV executives could barely to begin their luck of this kind of plum piece of TV viewing that had been dumped in their laps. I should just say, I mean, it's quite a bold move by Kensington Palace to do that, because, of course, you know, they do need to work with national broadcasters, and the BBC, obviously, many would say, is the pinnacle of that. But also, of course, I think it's worth pointing out that, you know, over the last week, I've spent, you know, a week on tour with Charles and Camilla. Yesterday, I was with the Duchess of Cambridge at a brilliant school in North London, talking about early years. And today, after we've filmed this programme, Prince William will probably be giving one of his most moving and emotional speeches of his life about his work as an air ambulance pilot. All of which, of course, is not getting half the column inches they would if it wasn't for this documentary. So I think the fact that the palace are willing to sacrifice that shows you how angry they are.
Wow. And then we've got part two next week. What do you expect to be the fallout from that, if any?
Well, I suspect there will be quite a lot if what we're hearing is true. I mean, my very good media colleague on the Daily Mail, Paul Revoir, has been speaking to people, and everyone says people are rather getting their knickers in a twist about the wrong programme and the far more interesting one, which will specifically cover the Harry and Meghan fallout period, is going to be next week. And certainly the people I speak to are braced to see and probably will decide how far they will go with any action they take against the BBC once they see what is broadcast next Monday. BBC, of course, are probably rubbing their hands with glee all this publicity.
Such a roller coaster of emotions. Yet again, thank you very much, Rebecca English. Well, joining me on the panel this week are two Right Royal Richards, the Daily Mail's editor-at-large, Richard Kay, and the paper's diary editor, Richard Eden. Welcome to you both, Messieurs Kay and Eden. Richard Kay, let's start with you. BBC sort of lurching into yet another royal crisis. But do you think this one was avoidable?
I think it was. I think it was entirely self-inflicted. I mean, the BBC announced that they were making, or it was announced that they were making this documentary about the activities of the press who report on the royals quite some time ago. And there has been, as time gone on, an increasing sense of nervousness within the palace as to what the BBC might be up to, but also within the BBC, I believe, because they weren't sure what the palace's reaction was going to be. They should have known, of course, but they chose to keep the whole project so secret, so tight. Inevitably, it increased the rumours and the speculation.
Richard Eden, a story of yours popped up in the documentary I saw you tweeting about yesterday. Tell us what happened.
It was hard not to get slightly outraged as I was watching it.
I've never seen you outraged.
I saw the words, you know, come up on screen, and then they had Meghan's great cheerleader, Omid Scobie, sort of analyse the story and give Meghan's view of it. But no one from the BBC contacted me. I mean, it was very discourteous, I'd say. What the story was...
But also, it's just not very thorough, is it? Why would they not contact you about that?
Good question. Mm. No, one to address to the BBC. I mean, what the story was, but it was quite an important one because it was about the departure of Meghan's right-hand woman, her PA. And it was the first story that sort of gave a hint of problems about employment and people who worked for Meghan. And the story was correct. This PA had quit suddenly. And in the article, we had royal sources singing the praises of the woman who'd departed, called Melissa. And this seemed to be what had outraged Meghan, that she felt, according to Omid Scobie, that why on earth are these sources praising the person who worked for me and not defending me, sort of thing. But it was very strange, the whole thing. And then they had Meghan's on the programme. Then they had Meghan's lawyer just saying, oh, it's all untrue. Well, it wasn't untrue at all. It was this woman had left. That was what I reported.
Mm. And Richard Kay, there were also, I saw your piece yesterday in the Daily Mail talking about some glaring errors.
Well, it wasn't. Yeah, there were many glaring errors in it, but I think Richard's touched on an important point. They afforded this courtesy of having Meghan's mouthpiece, her lawyer, interviewed on the programme, a courtesy not extended to other royal households, by all accounts. And this woman, the lawyer, was able to say things which were entirely unchallenged. She flatly denied the story that Richard was talking about just there, about that Meghan had been a bullying boss. Well, these bullying accusations are the centre of an internal palace inquiry. It hasn't reported yet. And she, the lawyer, was not there. Mm. She is in no position to say they are false and untrue. She should have said, in my view, I'm advised by my client that these claims are false and untrue, but she stated it as a fact, and the BBC presenter did not go back and challenge her on that.
Do you have a view on what the agenda has been here, considering that all the kowtowing has been to the Sussex side, when real gatekeeping against the royal family?
Well, if we're talking about the agenda of the BBC or the agenda of
those
with the programme makers,
yeah.
Well, I mean, they clearly wanted to make some mischief. There's always been, the BBC have always had this sort of unhealthy fascination with the activities of principally the tabloid press and the royal press in particular. For years, they've written and carried sort of slightly disparaging items about the activities of us. And I guess that's part of it. And they also know it's an intriguing situation. It gets them, it gives them an opportunity to get into a sort of a tabloidy kind of story, if you like, i.e. the royal story. The BBC like to be very lofty and stand above it, and well, we wouldn't dirty our fingers with something like that. But this is a way for them to do it.
Yeah.
I mean, as to quite what their point of it all is, I mean, I think that the whole slant of the programme was loaded. It was loaded against the royals, and it was clearly it was loaded against the press.
Yeah. Did you find that, Richard, that it's just this, you know, it's tabloid fodder dressed up as an analysis of the media?
I think it was. I think it was. It came from a perspective of being hostile to the royal family and definitely hostile to the press. I mean, Richard, in an article this week, highlighted a very interesting point, which was that this Omid Scobie character I just talked about, he was allowed to say...
You love him, don't you?
Well, he was very dominant in this in the first part of this programme. And he was allowed to say that, oh, yes, I was the only mixed-race royal correspondent. And apparently he's half Scottish, half Persian. Well, on the same programme, they had the Sunday Times royal correspondent, who is Roy Anika, who is... you know, his ethnic descent, and then there are others as well. And no one said to him, the presenter, that, wait a minute, sorry, can we check that? I mean, if you're a journalist, as the presenter claims to be, then you pick up on things, you ask people.
What was that cheeky laugh?
Well, I mean, Richard's claim that the presenter is a journalist as he claims to be.
I'm enjoying this, but Richard Kay, you... talked also yesterday in this piece about these familial sort of like, you know, battling is something that isn't new, even though it was presented in this.
Well, there's a kind of naivety. I mean, Amal Rajan, who's the presenter of this programme for the BBC, has sort of taken it as though the world started when he decided his film began, which is, he's looking at 2012 to 2018. Well, I can go back a little bit further than him, and certainly in the 1990s, the counter-briefing and briefing against individual members of the royal family was something which happened all the time. And it happened most famously, clearly, in the breakdown of the marriage between the Prince and Princess of Wales. And both sides were sort of lobbing grenades at each other through the prism of the press. It happened then, after Diana's death, in the years when the Prince of Wales was trying to get the public to accept Camilla as a potential royal partner stroke bride. And when people pushed back on that, then Charles's side would let slip bombshells about other members of the royal family. I mean, those are facts. And so there was that sort of briefing and counter-briefing did go on.
And I mean, I was not a royal reporter in the 90s, and I remember that.
But
what did you make of the programme's presenter, Richard Eden?
Amal Rajan, I thought it was very interesting because it seemed to be, to my eyes, a sort of vehicle that the BBC had created for their star presenter. So it was really all about him. I mean, he didn't seem to be particularly knowledgeable about the royals, but he was centre stage and he was wearing a selection of shirts. I thought the most revealing thing on this programme...
Did you want him to not wear a shirt?
The most revealing thing on this programme were his shirts. You know, they really were.
Did he have one as nice as this?
He had them.
That's what I want to know.
He had them unbuttoned, you know, further than you. And unlike yourself, he was showing off his hairy chest.
Not today.
His chain, you know, and it really was a sort of bit of a sort of chest-bearing exercise, I thought. So,
I was going to say, but let me just interrupt. Isn't there something critical about Amal Rajan? Because his position, where he comes from, I mean, he is an ex-Fleet Street editor and a journalist, of course he is. Very ambitious man and very highly regarded in the BBC, but someone with a bit of baggage where the royals come in, because he, you know, he's a self-declared Republican. Mm. He's written about how silly he thinks the whole institution is and absurd, I think he used it once. And I think that's context, and that's something which perhaps the BBC should have acknowledged or should have been placed more centrally, perhaps, in the programme.
Look, the BBC doesn't have on Match of the Day, it doesn't cover football with someone who hates football, does it? I think it's ridiculous. If you're coming from that hostile perspective of, oh, I hate them, then, you know, that puts the programme in question, I would say, from the start, really.
What do you think, Richard Kay? You have obviously been front row seat for the relationship between the Palace and the BBC, seen it ebb and flow over the years, high points, low points. How good or bad is it now?
Well, I think things were pretty bad post the revelations about Martin Bashir and Panorama, you know, the BBC are desperate to move on from that period.
Oh, well, then this was a good move, then.
But this was not the best way to move on. Yeah. And crucially, Prince William is not yet prepared to forgive them for what he considers they did in tricking them, his mother, into giving that interview. And I think his reaction to all this, his decision to move a very important programme, which was designated for BBC coverage, to ITV, is a demonstration of how bad things could get, and they could get a lot worse.